You never know what's going to happen.
Exclusively.
What is this?
77 WABC.
This Thursday, this is true, to show his appreciation, President-elect Trump will be going on a thank you tour. Yeah, the tour starts in Moscow and makes its way slowly through the Ukraine.
That is not funny, Sid.
That is really funny.
Not funny at all.
Nailed it.
Welcome back. Hour number two of the Bernie and Sid Show with a great song by the Rolling Stones in the background. Here on 77 WABC, our exciting hour number one. Bo Dietl was here running, of course, for mayor in New York City. Then Arthur Idala with his major announcement. Maybe Brooklyn DA. He'll do something in public office here in New York. And now we've got this. So I get up this morning, and I've been hearing reports for a couple of days, you and I, Bernard, that our great buddy from Massachusetts, Scott Brown, is being considered in a big way for the Secretary of Veteran Affairs. So that's great. So I send out a tweet this morning, a public tweet, mind you, Bernard, that says, great luck to my buddy Scott Brown on getting a gig with Donald Trump in his cabinet. Okay, I got to tell you, maybe 20 minutes later, I get a direct message. This type of guy Scott Brown is. I get a direct message from Scott Brown saying, thanks, Sid. How many guys would do that?
Yeah, that's pretty cool.
With all that said, joining us right now, a guy that I know you love and I love and we all love out of Massachusetts, the great Scott Brown. Good morning, Scott.
Yeah. Hey, good morning, Sid. Bernie, how you doing? Happy day to everybody in New York. It's a beautiful day.
It is a happy day. It's actually a great week for this nation, I would say. First, you had, even though it was in our hemisphere, the death of Castro. You have... You have Carrier Air Conditioning staying in Indianapolis. Donald Trump, the guy who you were on that bandwagon way early, Scott Brown was. And Trump's going out for his thank you tour, which is unprecedented. What president-elect has ever done this before?
Well, exactly. And he's not like any other president-elect. And the fact that he's not even the president yet, and he's going out and doing what he said he would do, which is try to save jobs and keep them in the country. And just by lowering the corporate tax rates down to 15, 16, 17, whatever that number that is, percent, repatriating all that offshore money, which is upwards of $3 trillion, and then streamlining regulations, you're creating an automatic pay raise for every business, every person that owns a business, unless they're a sole proprietor, and they use flow through, or they use the Social Security numbers, and that's next. So it's a good day, as evidenced by the stock market, as evidenced by the feeling that people are going out and buying, they're buying homes, you know, they just feel good, and that's a good thing.
It's my job, Scott, to kind of piss on the parade just a little bit. I'm sorry, but I got to speak for the critics. I don't necessarily feel this way, but I got to bring it up anyway. The Carrier deal, for example, Scott, in Indiana, okay, here's what they say. First of all, Josh Ohnus comes out and says, that's great. He's done 805 more. He'll reach Barack Obama. Then you guys just say, listen, the fact is all the AC jobs are still going to Mexico. Mike Pence is the governor in Indiana, so there's obviously that's not a coincidence that the deal gets done in Indiana. Who knows what backwards money is going where. Indiana people are still going to be taxed pretty heavily to keep those jobs in the state. What about some of the criticism leveled at what looks like a home run?
Well, actually, all good points, Sid. All good points, but here it is. He's not the president yet, and yet he's already doing this. And the fact that he's creating an environment for other businesses to say, you know what, we're going to think things over a little bit, because you have the rule of law here in the United States. You have, I think, the best workers in the world here in the United States. And you have the ability to lower corporate tax rates and become competitive on a global basis. I think all leads to the fact that not only Carrier, but other companies will stay in effect. And we don't know, I don't know yet what the actual deal is, but I know just by lowering corporate tax rates and keeping that good rule of law and streamlining regulations, there may have been some, local city or state incentives that we give to many businesses to keep them there. And I think that's all a positive thing, especially if you're continuing to hire, keep people in that city, and those payroll taxes and other taxes will help offset any type of incentives that they ultimately got. So it's the beginning, and
that's
people
right.
can be naysayers, but it's just that he hasn't even been elected yet, and he's already out hustling.
These guys are unbelievable, looking at a gift horse in the mouth. The man is, you look, the symbolism alone, Scott, as a Senator Brown, let me just address you by your title. Look, the symbolism, the message it sends to other people, as you pointed out, but just he exudes winner. I mean, it reminds me of Ronald Reagan when, before he took office, the Iranians releasing the hostages, getting things done before he takes off. Just the idea that he's doing so. And as far as making America economically great again, you mentioned repatriating the money, the tax reform, all of that stuff. Also, the other component, I would say, is that making the country energy independent, lifting all those regulations.
Right.
Exploiting the gas, the coal, and the oil that we have that this administration has handcuffed our own energy companies in this country from doing it.
And I believe that's accurate, and I believe we also need to do it in an environmentally responsible way, and I believe we have the engineers and people who understand how to do it better than anyone in the world, and we can do it. And we can do it in a thoughtful, methodical, you know, conservation-friendly, environmentally friendly way. But to think that we just don't do it just because we're kowtowing to the radical environmentalists is wrong. We need to become energy independent. You say, well, energy's so low. Yeah, it's low today, but what about in 2, 3, 4, 5 years? That's the problem. We need to think, you know, for 5, 10, 15, 20, 50-year plan, and that's what I hope he does.
Okay, you're our favorite politician from Massachusetts. It's not even close, Scott, okay? But there's another politician from Massachusetts who's been in the news lately. Shockingly, after a second get-together, a dinner, mind you, at a very nice restaurant 2 nights ago, Mitt Romney, of all people, the same guy that savaged Donald Trump not that long ago, eviscerated Donald Trump and took him to task on a personal level. Looks like he's got the inside track on Secretary of State. Be honest, Scott. Are you shocked, or is Donald Trump that type of guy?
No, listen, I told the president-elect that it would be a great choice, and here's why. Yeah, you get two billionaires who kick the crap out of each other, and they got really personal. But you know what happened after that? They both sucked it up, and they said, you know what? We're both type A. We're both hard chargers. We both want to win. And they had the good sense, and I thought class, to actually get together, not once, but twice, and probably have spoken many other times, and say, you know what? We got something special here. Let's go try to make it even more special. And I think it's the Abraham Lincoln approach where he brought in his rivals and people that didn't get along with him because he wants differences of opinion. He doesn't want all, you know, butt kissers up there. Oh, yes, Mr. Trump, you're great, sir, you're great. He wants people who are going to disagree with him. And the fact that he can bring in his rival, I think is a good thing. People respect Mitt Romney. They, you know, the Never Trumpers, they're pissed off. I get it. I get it. But there's another segment that really, really respect and like Mitt Romney, like me. And I love Donald Trump, too. So there are people like that as well. And to think somebody who has saved the Olympics for Salt Lake City, he's done some wonderful things, obviously, business-wise. Our allies will respect us. I know our foes will fear us. So to me, it makes a lot of sense. And here's what I think happened. They got together, and Mitt probably, because I know it, probably said, listen, Mr. President-elect, I just want to tell you, first of all, congratulations. And I want to apologize. I was out of line for whatever reason. It's not my style. I apologize. What can I do to help? That's probably what happened. I bet you.
Do you think, Scott, that he actually said to Donald Trump afterwards, "Hey, listen, by the way, I just apologize. Please don't tell anybody I did that."
No. I think the one thing I know about Donald Trump is that he's a classy guy. He gets it. He gets it when somebody comes and looks him in the eye and says, "You know what, sir? You know, I screwed up. You know, I screwed up." He's not going to necessarily rub their face in it. If it's not genuine, he will. But if it's truly genuine, which I believe it was, then I think he's going to say, you know what, Mitt's a good guy. He's a hustler. He's a type A like me, and he brings value. And he wants the best people around him, period. And that adds value to me. And I think it sets a great example for our own party, but most importantly to the people on the far left who are destroying, you know, tearing down flags out of schools, you know, protesting every day about something, you know, and it's a good example that even people who didn't get along can actually get along for the betterment of our country.
It is refreshing that Trump can rise above it, as you say, and put that behind him. But there are people out there like Kellyanne Conway, Mike Huckabee, even Newt Gingrich called Mitt Romney a suck-up. And that he just wasn't loyal, and there is something to be said about loyalty. I mean, Gingrich and
of course there is, Bernie,
and Giuliani, they were loyal, and while they didn't hide when the going got tough, and so that's
why. Go ahead. I'm sorry. Go ahead.
Well, there is that sentiment out there, and there's something to be said for it.
Of course there is, but listen, you know, the only person that matters out of all the people you reference is the president-elect. It's his decision, period. Yeah. And if the others don't like it, well, too bad. He's going to put the people around him who he feels can put the best team together to make America great again. And I believe he's doing just that.
You know, and just one more thing on the Secretary of State thing. I think Trump went out of his way to say it's going to be a different era here with foreign policy. It's going to be America first. And he cited the Iraq War. And I think that there should be a litmus test. If you have not learned the lesson of the Iraq War, that should be, was the Iraq War a mistake or was it not a mistake? For example, if they're floating John Bolton. He can never be Secretary of State in a Trump administration if Trump is to be consistent and true to his word. And I wonder, I don't know what Mitt Romney's position is on the Iraq War, for example, or on regime change. Are we going to invite al-Sisi from Egypt to the White House, which we should, because he's not a democratically elected guy, but he's still our friend in the Middle East. I mean, those are the things that I want to know about my Secretary of State.
Yeah, of course. And the Secretary of State is there to give guidance to the president, and that decision is ultimately up to him. And it's easy to quarterback about Iraq. And here's the problem with Iraq. Had we left a transition force, a quick reaction training force there, instead of abandoning Iraq, we would not have the problems we have there in the Middle East, I believe, and others believe as well, who are much more knowledgeable and experienced than me. Had we left a 10,000, give it
that's
take,
true. That's all true.
By our generals on the ground, instead of leaving a vacuum. Remember, ISIS said to Al-Qaeda of Iraq, said, hey, don't come here anymore. We lost. Go someplace else. And then we left, and then not only did Al-Qaeda of Iraq morph into ISIS, which is bigger than New England, and have into this force we see today, you know, we also set the tone, and not only for Syria when we drew a red line and did nothing, and then, you know, emboldened Putin with Crimea and Ukraine and emboldened China to build islands. It's all a chain reaction from those poor decisions. I'm not opposed to going in and getting rid of a dictator like Saddam Hussein. Okay, you know, based on what we find now is faulty material. It was the best we had, and we made a logical decision. Was it the right decision? You know, even a Monday morning quarterback.
We should have left him there. We should leave Bashar Assad there.
Yeah, we need to clean up our mess, and we didn't.
Right. That's a fact. I have to defend Bernard here only because, and I agree with you, I think the Iraq thing is perfect Monday morning quarterback. Republicans were for it. Democrats were for it. Everybody was for it. But I will say this. I remember the very next morning, I'm going to give Bernard a pat on the back here, working on the I Miss in the Morning show. Bernard was furious on air, Scott Brown, yelling and screaming that this is going to be the biggest mistake the U.S. is going to make.
It doesn't matter if you were for or against it. Did you learn the lesson of the folly that it was, the invasion itself, and taking out dictators like Gaddafi, the guy in Egypt. Before Morsi. Mubarak.
Mubarak.
Leave these guys there. They're our friends.
You see, but here's a problem, because what happens is things got worse after that, Scott. So now we're actually thinking about leaving horrible men who murder, who genocide in their own country in power, because in these situations, things got worse afterwards. To me, that's not really a great call, is it?
You know, it's tough. It's a tough call.
Right.
Whatever happens, I think you're referring to obviously Syria and what that's such a complete screw up under this administration that it's going to take, I think, generations to figure that out.
Agreed. Now, listen, we're talking about Secretary of State, but there are tons of other positions that Donald Trump has filled and still has to fill. And it makes our hearts warm here on the Bernie and Sid show that Scott Brown is being considered for a very prominent position, one that we desperately need help with. I thought McDonald would be good, I'll be honest with you. But the truth is, not much has changed. So I don't know what you can say, what you can't say, but according to reports, you're being considered for the Secretary of Veteran Affairs. How's that going?
I had a great meeting with him. He's known prior to this my feelings of it. I served 35 years, last four at the Pentagon, retired as a colonel a couple of years ago. Been serving on Veterans Committee since I was a state rep, state senator, U.S. senator. You know, our family has been involved in philanthropic veterans causes forever. I mean, Ayla's performed herself five times at the AFE tour overseas. So, you know, we live and breathe it. And listen, I think it's the toughest job. It has the second largest budget. And here's why it's the toughest job, because while there are angels working there, really, truly wonderful angels in all parts of it, there's also some folks there that shouldn't be there. They need to go. and there needs to be some really dramatic changes in certain areas to stop and reduce suicide, to get people mental health care that they need, reducing the lines, and streamlining and consolidating, getting better value for our tax dollars. And people are dying.
And
it's real. It's the toughest job because people are dying like daily.
And who better than Senator Scott Brown, who spent 30 years in the military? You retired as a colonel. You were an infantry officer. And who better than somebody like you to run an administration like that?
Well, listen, but thank you. But to think, you know, that 35 years is the only qualification, I'm going to be brutally honest with you. I'm not going to be able to do it myself. I'm going to need every nonprofit veterans group and to help, it's almost going to be like a public-private partnership. I'm going to need I'm going to need Chuck Schumer. I'm going to need Gillibrand. I'm going to need all the congressmen, the mayor of New York City and others to do their part. And we need to work in a partnership because it's not about me. It's not about Donald Trump. You know, it's not about Scott ran and lost or ran and won. It's not about that. It's about people dying.
Yeah.
And they need our help.
Yeah.
Period.
You know, on the way out, though, I've heard a lot of people say this. You've already had a very distinguished Scott Brown political career, Senator of Massachusetts, all that great stuff. And you've done a terrific job. But I've heard other people say this, too, that with all I've done, if, in fact, I do end up with a position with Donald Trump, this is like the ultimate honor. This is I couldn't even dream of something like this. Are you in that same camp?
Yeah, listen, I've run 21 races. I'm 19-2, and every one of them has special moments. But to represent our country when the president-elect calls, I'm not familiar with what that's like yet because every interaction I've had with a president was President Obama, and it wasn't good.
Right.
it'll be an honor, and it'll be even more of an honor because it's something that I'm so passionate, like you and everyone listening is, regardless of your political stripes, is that, hey, listen, we have people who are volunteering and they're in trouble and they need help, and let's just cut the crap and join forces and get it done, period. So that's why it's a daunting. I haven't slept in like 5 days just thinking about it, trying to figure out how to really nail it down and maximize, you know, everything. And, you know, feeling better and better, but, you know, and the process is in its ordinary course. I'm not, you know, concerned either way when I hear various names. I know where I stand. I know my qualifications. If he wants me, great. If he doesn't, you know, however I can serve, I'm ready to do it.
Well, you're a good man. Fingers crossed, Scott Brown, former senator from Massachusetts. Trump is listening right now on his way to the airport out to Indianapolis. I guarantee you. He's heard you, and we wish you all the best, Scott.
Absolutely.
Brown.
All right, good. Hey, you guys have a great week, and we'll see you hopefully, Bernie and Sid, before the holidays. We'll grab some beers, okay?
Sounds good.
Forward
to
it.
Yeah,
thanks,
Bernie and Sid, back after this.